Those go to restaurants, yeah, the big box. Sometimes grocery stores will go and buy, like, you know, bulk to go and put in a bulk bin, but a lot of time the restaurants get that. They don't, you know, they don't need the packs necessarily.
The way that I see these mushrooms is that they're super plump, and that's what I really like about them. They're not too discolored, and the fact that they're all in the pretty much the same shape and color is a really good sign that these are gonna be good for today. These are gonna be some trumpet mushrooms. These are like super meaty. They have a lot of hyphae that's like really entangled. So that really makes it more chewy and more toothsome.
The mushrooms that we grow tend to kind of be like a pom-pom shape, which a lot of our customers appreciate.
I love these. These kind of look like something from like Willy Wonka. If you actually had like a trip, you can see like these mushrooms and kind of look like they're from in another world. You know, if you're a person who's not really fond of a mushroom, treat the mushroom as if you're treating a piece of beef. Give it a little thought and care to it, and you're gonna be surprised about what you're gonna get after that. So the dish that we're gonna be making is, it's called namgul. It's garlic oil, and I wanna make sure that all of it's covered. Because the thing about mushrooms is that they don't have a lot of moisture content and they're really dry. So we want to hydrate them and kind of lubricate them. We smoke the king trumpet mushrooms and the maitakes. They get this super nice pink hue to it, as if you were getting a smoke ring. But on the outside of it, I'm going to start basting it with this fermented bean curd sauce. And what you're going to get is a lot of cheesy notes. And you don't think Asian food and cheesy notes, but with the development of the fermentation process, you're gonna get a lot of funk that's gonna come out of it. Mushrooms should not be underplayed. A quality of a mushroom can kind of like surprise you. So this is gonna be a fried sweet potato fritter. We're gonna go and use the mushrooms that we grilled to kind of top it off. Geneen food is all about sharing. We present it with a bunch of herbs and lettuce so that way they can wrap it up. All these components play a different part. Pretty much the highlight of this dish along with these mushrooms is gonna be the herbs.
Mushrooms are magical. They have so much mystery. I always think about how humans try to explain so much. And the more we learn about mushrooms, the more we realize that we don't even have the language to explain it. Even us trying to talk about mycelium digesting substrate or even a fruiting body coming out of a block, it's us trying to use our own language and experience to explain something that is completely beyond us. I'm Andrew Carter, and we're in Smallhold's Brooklyn Macro Farm. How mushrooms grow. Originally, this was sawdust. All the raw material is then hydrated and sterilized, and then seeded, essentially, with the mycelium. It's inoculation, technically, but seeding is probably the easier way to think about it. So what you're looking at here is a bag of fully colonized mycelium, ready to fruit. Originally, this was pure sawdust, and so we call the sawdust substrate, which is food for the mycelium. Mycelium is the living organism, and so the best parallel is an apple tree. The mycelium would be the tree, and the mushroom that you eat would be the apple that falls off of the tree. The living organism is this thing that it's hard for humans to really comprehend and really understand. It's this net of an organism here that is makes its way through whatever substrate you have, either in a bag or a bottle or however you're growing it. A world without mycelium wouldn't be a world. You know, it wouldn't exist. It's highly likely we wouldn't have anything we would have right now. But what we're doing in here is imitating exactly where these grow. A lot of the mushrooms that we grow in kind of near the surface of a forest. And a lot of the time that's actually a fairly humid and cool environment. We have certain temperatures that we fluctuate throughout the day and throughout the week. We have certain humidity set points that we're managing throughout the day and the week for each of these varieties to make sure that they have the best experience possible. The lighting is very strategic, it's technical. Fungi have its own kingdom, and so they don't do photosynthesis to create energy, but they do need light to grow. The mushrooms that we grow tend to like about 410 to 450 nanometers, which is essentially blue into a little bit of UV. But what's happening is that the mycelium itself is ready to fruit, and then it needs a trigger to tell it to fruit and to set those pins that eventually will become the fruiting body. The light does that. This is a lion's mane growing out. This is actually going to be a fully fruit body formation probably over the next 2 to 3 days. It'll triple in size throughout that process. These are blue oysters. These are ready to harvest. We have some pink oysters here. Normally the pink oysters would actually be in a little different environment. They're tropical, and so they actually can be part of a little warmer of an area. And normally you'd never find a tree just fruiting that much pink oysters, which is again kind of the power of doing it in controlled environments and controlled spaces like this. And then we have some yellow oysters here, which are also about ready to go. So each of these are completely different varieties. And so even a blue oyster and a pink oyster and a yellow oyster and a king oyster or a royal trumpet, they're very different varieties. They're all Pleurotus, but they come from different regions and they grow completely differently. So we have different holes for different varieties. And so as you can see, this we have certain holes on certain sides. What we're really trying to do is allow the mushroom to focus its energy on creating the fruiting bodies in certain spaces. And so technically you could grow one, you could put one hole here and then you could have a larger fruiting body, or you could put a bunch of holes here and you could have a bunch of smaller fruiting bodies. We found that doing it on one side tends to be the best experience for the lion's mane, for example. My whole career has been growing plants. Like, that's what I spent actually more time doing than growing mushrooms. I originally thought there would be a lot of similarities between the plants and the mushrooms, but it turns out the more we learn about them, they're drastically different. We're about to pick a bunch of mushrooms. Today it's going to be some royal trumpets, some blue oysters, and some lion's mane. These are blue oysters. To harvest these is pretty easy. You just kind of pick it off. You can see a nice blue color in here, and a lot of that has to do with the temperature that it's in. You know, there are all sorts of ways that you can grow these, but when it's exposed to a nice cool temperature like you have in here, you'll see that you get a nice blue color essentially. They grow in these clusters, which are really nice, but these tend to be like kind of the perfect one for our customers. Some customers really like whole clusters when you're doing it in bulk. You know, we have some restaurant customers that'll serve a whole cluster and roast it, put some like egg yolk in it, or you know, have a nice little menu item with that. But then when we're packing it in the packs, we usually kind of break it up a little bit, because we're pretty specific in how much needs to be in each of those packs. This is the fruiting body of the fungus that we're growing. This is where the mushroom kind of popped out of the substrate too. You can see the younger sort of fruiting bodies that came out of this cluster, but it's a very dense mushroom. You know, these are good and healthy clusters.
I'm about to harvest some kings, and then we're gonna pack those up into some clamshells and some 5-pound boxes too. Kind of looking for like an umbrella style cap. Kings can get really big. When they're healthy and they're happy, they can get as big as this. This is probably around as big as they get. The color on the caps is really nice too. It's a nice dark brown. And these are still kind of down, kind of like an umbrella. So this is probably like peak time to be harvesting these. You could tell kind of the age of a mushroom. The term for like a baby mushroom is a pin. Say this is right when we harvest it, as big as it gets. And then these little guys in here, these are baby pins. And the pins will turn into these giant kings over the span of, you know, 7 to 9 days. So it's really quick. So you see it growing kind of in front of you, which is really unique in urban agriculture or agriculture, that you could see it happen so quickly. So usually we can get up to 2 to 3 pounds off of a block. From eyesight here, this is probably 12 pounds. I just finished harvesting off of like 3 or 4 blocks.
What we're doing is we're packing them in our eco pack. This is compostable and recyclable, no plastic, no styrofoam. You know, we bring these to our stores. What we really want to do is create a package that really inspires people in the grocery store. It's not necessarily like colors
related to the mushrooms, but generally the mushroom section is pretty boring. And so we think that by bringing some nice color in and by bringing nice packaging and obviously a really fresh mushroom, especially like some of the special mushrooms, we can really excite people in the grocery store. That's kind of the idea there. So these you can just pick off and you see they're kind of brain-like. They're structurally very different than the other mushrooms, but people make like pulled pork out of these, crab cakes. We're packing a pack with some lion's mane and some royal trumpets. This is a fancy pack from Smallhold. We call it the fancy pack because it's a bunch of mushrooms that some people think are fancy. We believe that in time, these will be the mushrooms that everyone eats. We've done our job if they become not fancy anymore. We try all sorts of different mixes for people, seeing what, you know, what people like to cook together. And we want this to be the center of the plate. A lot of people will sell a 3-ounce pack or a smaller pack because they're putting mushrooms kind of on the side. But what we believe is that by giving people more mushrooms, people will eat more mushrooms and they'll start to replace that steak or that hamburger with a bunch of different types of mushrooms, essentially.
These are going out to Union Market. They're getting these two variety packs, and it's going to go straight from the farm to their shelves.
There's so many reasons why I love mushrooms. At its base level, they grow off of waste streams. It's not very common to find a product that's as ecologically sustainable that also can feed so many people. Mushrooms, I think, are going to feed the world. They already are, but it's only going to be up from here.
Hey, Carlos, how's it going, man? Doing all right? Good. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Got some mushrooms for you. Where do you want me to drop these guys off?
Right here. I got this.
Oh, perfect. Awesome.
There are so many mushrooms, like all the mushrooms that we grow, that are completely underrepresented, not only in restaurants but also in the grocery stores and just sort of mass, the masses and their flavors and how people buy mushrooms. Because of that, we can bring pink oysters or we can bring royal trumpets to a consumer and we can completely blow their minds.